You are listening to a Clarkesworld Magazine podcast, and I'm your host and narrator, Kate Baker. Greetings, Clarkesworld citizens. Welcome to September. In September, we find that a lot of our funding is now gone, thanks to some changes that Amazon has made. So before we get into this podcast, please, 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 if you can reach into those pockets, go to patreon.com/Clarkesworld. We need you to help us get on a more stable footing than we have been. Again, that's patreon.com/Clarkesworld. To those of you who already are, I cannot thank you enough. You are the lifeblood of this magazine. You help us keep going each and every month. So aside from that, how's your September going? Our first story for the month of September is Stones. It is by Nnedi Okorafor. Nnedi Okorafor is a New York Times best-selling writer of science fiction and fantasy for both children and adults. She is the winner of the Nebula, World Fantasy, Eisner, Lodestar, Locus Award, and multiple Hugo Awards. And her debut novel, Zara the Windseeker, won the prestigious Wole Soyinka Prize for Literature. Nnedi has also written comics for Marvel, including Black Panther, Long Live the King, and Wakanda Forever, and the Shuri series. Nnedi has several works in development for TV and film. She lives with her daughter in Phoenix, Arizona. Learn more about Nnedi at Nnedi.com. So, my dear listeners, I hope you can sit back, relax, and let me tell you a story. I don't know if I can die. Maybe when this comet reaches the sun, I'll keep right on being. Or maybe then, finally, after so long, I will stop. I'm not ready to find out. I want to be immortal, to never die as those on your planet do. This place isn't how I remember it. It is ugly. Yet it's the place of my birth. How can that be? I have been to enough places to know what beauty is. I have not seen the entire universe, but I have seen much. To end my existence here, in the place where I started it, would negate all that I have come to believe. Of course, there is so much I will never know. Like, I don't know where I come from or what I am. You probably didn't expect to hear from me again. There is so much you could never have known. So that's understandable. But from the moment I left you, I knew I would speak to you again. And I knew it would be in this way. My mind was not light when I left you. And now I find myself a pile of stones, unable to leave this place as it hurls toward the sun. So it may be now or never. I will tell you my story, and then I will see if it's the end. I will speak in the way you and I came to communicate. It is a thing I most enjoyed during our brief time together. Knowing how to conceptualize, to define, and to articulate is your second greatest gift to me. But let me also make it clear, this message is not just me talking and telling. It is first and foremost an apology. I will say it many times in this message, but let me say it this first time before I begin. I am sorry. Okay, I'm ready. I woke on this comet as it passed the planet of Saturn. I remember this because Saturn was the first thing I ever saw, and my very first thought was that it was lovely. I could not yet communicate it to another, but I knew what lovely was. I knew how to articulate it in my mind. I knew what my mind was. There was so much I understood without experience, and I instinctively knew how to bring my body together from the tiny to large blue, gray, silver and bronze stones. I pulled myself into the form that I would have from then on. Nebulous silver orb around my bronze head, bronze face, bronze shoulders and arms, blue body and rocket thrusters. On the inside, I was warm, the heat I produced effortless and constant. I don't breathe gases as you do, and your kind do. I cannot imagine what it would be like to need to do such a thing. All the time. To die if I were to stop. To be unable to peruse the vacuum of space. Nevertheless, I was aware of myself. I was not part of the comet. I lifted up and hovered above its surface. I made my gray stones meld into a rocket, and my silver stones tumbled and whirled around my head like the comet's long tail of stone and dust. When I'd floated out enough to see the sun for the first time, I made my bronze face and arms shimmer in reflection of its beauty. One must honor a star. I would visit it when I was ready. For the time being, I returned to my comet and rested, watching Saturn as we moved past it. I settled into my body, turning my senses inward. What I discovered occupied me for some time. There was a universe inside me. This was a source of the heat. I gazed at it. Worlds, spaces, stones, dust. They tumbled and danced, dwelled, died, spawned. There was joy, adventure, explosion, movement, and billions of colors in me. I carried this within. Maybe it is where I come from. Myself. When I turned my attention outward again, I felt like more, and I saw more. The vastness of space made me want to spread and open myself to it and shout, "I am here." I did not fear death. That is something your kind does. I was freedom. Radiation is a passing wind to me. Heat is my existence, and it comes from inside me, so I always exist. The sun was now barely a speck. It was so cold and lonely there. I left the comet. I finally went out into the universe. It began with a smell, the smell of planets, nebula, comets, asteroids, meteorites, dust, gases, radiation. Yes, I can actually smell them. These smells move all around me. Where they are going, I do not know, but they always tell on themselves. The smells are alive in that they tell stories of their origins, where they come from, how to get there. I realized this after a while, and then, after a longer while, I understood that I could find the main characters of these stories the smells were telling. The first planet I found was a planet of sulfurous gas and red ices. In finding it, I learned that I could travel through space very fast. You cannot understand what it is to travel, what you consider light years and moments. To be human is to not be what I am. This is fine, but I can tell you this. It was the most enjoyable sensation I'd ever felt. I must have been made for this, to travel. In searching for and finding this first planet using the story of the smells, I came to understand my thrusters. They glowed with mighty heat and propelled me forth. The moment made my insides vibrate. And this gave me such pleasure that for a while I could do nothing but voyage. So enraptured I was in the passage of space all around me. I discovered love, for I was in love with travel. When I reached this first planet, it gave me more joy. The fact that there was something on the end of the travel was an additional reward. This planet had an atmosphere. What a thing it was to experience for the first time. Every part of me felt a pull and then a release. The planet was expecting, then welcoming me, then letting me explore. I blasted toward the planet's surface, anxious to see it up close. I felt gases in my face against my body. On my head, what you saw as long, puffy silver hair is just more of me. It drapes around me protectively, and when exceptionally happy and free, it spreads around my head, capturing the gases as I fly. I spiraled and twirled toward red spikes of frozen water. I crashed through them, sending weak, brittle shards all about. I screamed with laughter, slapping at the shards, dancing in the sparkles. This was the start of so much. I decided that I wanted to see everything I could see in the universe. I had recently come into being, yes, but I already knew so much. I knew what things were, but I knew I wanted to know more. So I explored many, many planets, some more than once. I burned, I froze, I vibrated. I was pressed, I was pulled. I plunged through suns. I tumbled across asteroids. I flew through the tails of comets. I visited moons. I communed with nebula. I saw much, even if it was only a fraction of what there is to see. I returned often to your solar system. However, there was one planet I avoided. It had one of the most complex scents I'd ever smelled. A dynamic plethora of so many stories. The scent of this planet told me the strangest stories I'd ever heard. It wasn't like the others, so I stayed away from it. Eventually, though, I just wanted something different. I'd been to Jupiter, Mars, Venus, all the other planets in your solar system. I even went to the sun. I touched its surface and gave it my intense respect. In return, it gave me something, too. A tiny glowing orb of hydrogen and helium that found a home inside me, in my inner universe. I wasn't far from your Earth when I coincidentally caught its scent full on. It rushed over my senses, and I saw strange volcanoes, creatures that grew, flourished, and died, strange motion, and so much water. Hot, cool, hardened, mist, and voices. So many voices. Most planets had one voice, or three or four, always a few. This place had an uncountable number. Some voices were enormous, but some were so tiny that I couldn't understand how they could be voices. And after the passage of some time, its scent had grown so much more complicated, active, and strange. Human beings and all that human beings did had sprung up. None of you were there the last time I had been close enough to catch Earth scent. My reluctant fascination and need to see this place surpassed my caution, and the great question that loomed just beneath my joy. Where did I come from? It was always there with every place I traveled, the possibility of an answer to that question, and the fact that it remained unanswered as I left each planet, asteroid, star, galaxy. Maybe I was from Earth. It seemed like a place that had a bit of everything. I couldn't stay away, and so after avoiding it for so long, I flew there. If it had been your human cities and raging highways that I came across first, I'd have fled the planet immediately. However, I splashed into an ocean, vast and blue and full of so many things. Life. I'd seen water before, and I happily plunged into it, but this water was like no water I'd ever encountered in all of my travels. Wiggling, twirling, multiplying, stretching, shrinking, swimming, squishing, living, dying, every drop had something going on in it. And there were bigger things moving about. I saw them. What you call a whale swam with me until she grew bored. For quite some time, the creature was curious, and she spoke to me too. I could understand, just as I eventually could understand you. She asked, "What do you think?" And I said, "I don't know." But I enjoyed being with her. When she asked me if there were others, I said, "No." I had always just been me from the moment I was. She said, "No one is an only, and I should find them." I had nothing to say to this. I was enjoying myself, however, not long after that. I came across my first human city. I was in the water, so it was from afar, but there were humans on the water before I reached it too. They gave the waters a twisted, dense smell. I didn't like it very much, but it was the mere sight of the glowing city in the nighttime that did it. Above, I could see the stars, the atmosphere and the lights blasting from the city drowned them out. There was noise, energy, but worst of all, way too many humans. There were more than any other large animal since I'd seen coming to this place. They overtook everything. It was all too weird for me and not in a good way. And in all that weirdness, there was no one like me. I was not carbon-based, as you even told me. More than any place I'd been, Earth bothered and disappointed me most. I had no urge to greet even one human. Not long after setting my sight on that one human city, I fled the planet. I left your solar system. For how long? In your way of measuring time? Maybe 100 years. That is a lot for you. It is nothing for me. I sniffed out and touched many planets, large, small, hot, cold. Strange, boring. I was seeing, but I was searching, too, for somebody like myself. That whale's ideas stayed with me. No one is an only. Still, I found no one like me. Eventually, I got to thinking about my comet. I wondered if I could find it again. Maybe I could find some answers on it. I knew the smell of the solar system, and soon I was close. I smelled the comet. It was near Saturn again. Then, I saw your space station. Through space not far from Saturn. When I was last in the solar system, humans did not have that capability to go this far yet. The space station was a golden color and very shiny. It smelled bitter. I flew to it and quickly saw humans on the outside of it, tethered to the space station with cords. They were in chunky spacesuits, but I know what humans look like. I stayed back and watched as they saw me and scrambled inside. This was the first time I'd allowed any human to set eyes on me, judging by how they immediately moved toward the opening in a section of the space station. They feared me. I was amused, so I stayed and waited to see what they'd do next. They came back out. There were 10 of them in those suits. They did not have thrusters like me, but they had something that propelled them forth. They were clumsy and unnatural here. They did not belong in space. I remember how small they were on Earth, their heads not bulbous like the helmets they wore, as I watched them from afar. Each had flesh of various shades, but none were white like these suits. They were closer now, and though they were small, I could smell them. A sweet smell that was also oily like a substance on a planet I'd once visited. They were afraid of me. Their suits gave off gases as they approached. They were close now. 3 carried a large, long metal thing. It was a dark gray. I'm thinking of everything I have learned from you about language, about human ways, about why. Why? I did not know how I was going to communicate with these humans at the time. I wasn't thinking about that as much as I was just curious and amused. I'd visited many planets. I'd encountered other life forms, nothing like me and nothing like those on Earth. But they were life forms. Some I could communicate with, most I could not. None of them behaved like human beings, thankfully. I stayed where I was as they approached, watching them watch me. They were moving slower now, probably unsure of what I'd do. They were communicating with each other. I could hear it in waves. I waited for them to speak to me. I've learned from you, so I could have learned from them, if that had been their intent. They pointed the long device at me, and something burst from it. It looked like blue-pink lightning. It felt like breakage. It forced me back, and they fired their weapon again, and it hit me again. And again. By the 4th time, I regained my composure. Sort of. I could feel the lightning rippling through every aspect of me, and not since I had come into being had I felt all that I was start fragmenting into many stones. Instinctively, I held myself together, and when I did this, oh, the pain. Pain. I never felt pain. I knew instantly what it was, though. Still, my body exclaimed, "What is this?" The humans were already fleeing back to their space station entrance. I don't know what happened next. I was unfamiliar with what I felt and how I reacted. I was experiencing pain. They had caused it. I'd been waiting to greet them, and instead they introduced me to a terrible sensation. In your time measurement, how old was I? Many, many thousands of years. I had done nothing but explore the galaxy and feel joy, and maybe even bring joy and wonder. I had harmed no one. I didn't know what harm was. I pulled and held myself together, then I reacted to the pain by lashing out. It was all I could think to do to make it stop. The cloud that floated around my head became sharp. I sliced all three of those carrying the device into pieces. Their suits opened up and their flesh separated from itself, splashing out and then freezing. I crushed their device with my stones. I moved faster than you can understand. The seven who were fleeing into the large opening in the space station had no chance. I sliced them each into pieces. I sent their parts scattering about around the space station. Some of their red liquid managed to splash across its white surface before freezing. Maybe it would eventually flake away, I didn't know. I was in pain. There were others inside the open entrance. I rushed into it and found myself in a large enclosure. And I could feel pressure and hear hissing as the opening behind me was suddenly cut off by a giant door. I could have just torn it open and flown off. The pain I was in made me angry. I had never felt anger before. I glared into the opening in front of me. I could see more humans staring back at me. This was them with no suits. Whatever they had done to me was still happening, and I had to make an effort to keep myself together. What had been easy now was so difficult, and this fueled my anger even more. I tore open their door. Your air, the pressure, even the hint of weight I felt did nothing to me. I have been to many planets. Each of them has a smell and a feel. I always adjust. It was no different here, even while fighting to stay together. There was sound here from the humans, from their vehicles. They fled like creatures I saw on Earth. They did not have another weapon to shoot at me, not one that made any difference. Where they were small, I was much bigger. I could not fit easily into their space, but because I was falling apart, I could squeeze in, changing the shape of my body. When you saw me, you described me as a giant human robot monster. You said I was shiny, and that when I moved, I crushed everything around me. You saw me after I'd managed to pull myself together just before I could do it no more. What must these people have seen? A wide, enormous, shiny metal surface and silver cloud filling their walkways. My thrusters were behind me, incinerating the walls and equipment as I tore through the space station. I wreaked havoc. I killed several humans. I left a trail of mutilated bodies and blood. I could smell each of you, so no one was safe. I was angry. I was in pain. And then I found myself in front of your door. I looked inside and came face to face with you. I clutched the doors to rip them open. I had killed every human on board but you. Your head would come off as easily as all the others. Your insides would spill out like Earth's waters. The smell of metal and dirt would rise from your quivering flesh as you fell. But in that moment, instead, I paused. I do not know human beings, so I could not read the look on your face. I didn't even understand the arrangement of your face. But you stood there. You did not flee or start making noise or try to shoot a weapon at me. That gave me pause. And then I fell apart. I simply couldn't hold myself together anymore, into a heap of stones. I lay there for some time, then you finally decided to come out. I remember the sound of the doors opening because it sounded like four doors had to open for you to come out. I could still smell things, too. The gas that plumed out when you emerged smelled like some of the places on Earth, where the green and brown creatures who grew in the dirt lived. You cowered for a while before you came and stood over me. You kicked one of my stones, and I tried with all my might to pull myself together, but I could not. I only caused a ripple of lightning to roll over me. You jumped back, but did not flee. You had a device in your hands. You ran off and were gone for some time. When you returned, you were breathing heavily. You stood over me for a long time. You touched one of my stones, picked it up, examined it. You said something to me, and I was surprised when I understood it. "Listen," you said. Then you began to gather up my stones. At this point, I could not even attempt to pull myself together. Whatever they had shot me with had taken all that. One by one, you brought my stones into those doors, to a very strange place. It was full of that smell. You spoke as you moved me. And I understood what you said. You told me that you'd studied a comet that was now on a collision course with the sun as it passed Saturn, and my stones looked to be made of the same material. You said you suspected this because you'd studied materials you'd mined from that comet for many years. You knew it when you saw it. You said that maybe I was born of that comet. I wanted to say more, but I couldn't speak. I could only listen. When you brought the stones that were my head to the room you were piling them in, I saw that you actually weren't alone. More of those creatures that lived in the dirt that I had seen on Earth were here, but a different type. They grew on the walls in the large room and hung down, winding themselves into a large, coiling bundle that quivered and hummed. They were purple and reminded me of nebula that I had flown through in my journeys. I had killed everyone on your space station. They did something to me, and I could not help myself. I was in pain. I was angry. I had memories of your planet that were bad. Humans had done something to me that was bad. However, still, I send you this message to tell you I am sorry. This was not like me. I do not know where I am from. You say I came from this comet that is now heading into the sun. Maybe this is true, but I am not one who extinguishes life, kills things alive. I am an explorer, a seer, a traveler, one who journeys to witness the universe. So I am sorry, listen, Chukuma. I speak your name because you taught me how to. Your name itself is an incantation. You are named Listen, and I listened. How well did I listen? I can recite all that you told me, as instead of killing me, you healed me. Unlike the others, you spoke to me from the beginning, and I quickly began to understand. As you spoke, you poured water on me. And some other things. I remember your words like a prayer to the sun. You said, "Listen to me. Call me Listen Chukuma, because that is my name. I don't know what you are. I think that you are female, even if you are a pile of rocks. I saw you from my console when you first appeared. I told the others that they should be kind to you, but they were afraid. We have been on the space station. That is what this place is for 15 years. All of us have become strange. However, you appeared, a 30-foot-tall woman creature spaceship in space, menacing with that halo of silver hair that floated all around you, eyes that flashed like storms on Jupiter. A giant thruster that could scorch our entire space station. All people saw was a threat, like some kind of Godzilla thing. On Earth, Godzilla is a kaiju, a great beast who makes no sense to anyone. Could you blame them? Some of the engineers had been working on a machine that could cause molecules to disassemble. We do not have guns here. So they used that on you. It's all they could think of. They were yelling at each other when you first appeared. I was at the meeting, attending virtually as always. Through the cam, everyone was shouting. They were afraid. They saw a monster, an alien. We are not even on Earth, and they saw an alien. We are the aliens out here. Strike first, they decided. I tried yelling, too. Wait, I said. Try and see. But no one could hear me. Everyone was on their feet, yelling. Someone even knocked over the robot that housed my camera. It was still on the floor when everyone left. Let me explain. I have not left my lab in 10 years. To help you, I stepped through those doors for the first time since I began here. I was not confined to my lab out of fear or because I was a prisoner. My confinement was my choice. Now I am alone here until others come. But that is an issue for later. I am from Oweri. I come from a family of farmers. One of the last in my country to actually farm yam. Most of the country's land is now dedicated to growing periwinkle grass, and all the other produce farms are owned and operated by Ultimate Core. I was expected to follow in my parents' footsteps. As my 3 sisters and 2 brothers did, my family is wealthy, independent. I was the youngest. Like everyone in my family, I loved the dirt. The soil is in my blood. But I wanted to study the dirt and soil on other planets, comets, the rocks hurling through space. I became a geologist and then an astronaut. 15 years ago, I was sent on a mission to explore debris collected from Saturn's rings, and really anything else we found. At the end of those 2 years, I found more than rocks and dust in my research. One day I saw something shimmering as it slowly floated by. I went out in my suit to collect some of it. When I brought it to my lab, I found that it was exactly what I thought it was. Spores. When I presented my findings to the space station team, everyone was fascinated. When I said I wanted to nourish the spores and see what they grew into, everyone was up in arms. I asked them what I was even here for, if not this. Extraterrestrial seed. I had been studying for exactly this all my life. When I spoke to my sisters and brothers back home, they crowded around the camera to tell me what I already wanted to do. Make it grow, they shouted. I made a deal with everyone on the space station and our governments on Earth. I would cultivate the spores in this lab. It has its own air circulation, water source, food delivered by robots. My family was behind me all the way. We are people who grow plants, and so here I am. 1 decade. And you see that I have succeeded. I do not know what these plants are, but I know they can receive and send messages using radio waves. Through their leaves, I have heard things from across the galaxy, maybe even universe. I don't know how much you will understand if I explain it to you. I don't quite have the vocabulary for it yet. Someday I will. And I have seen no one in person for 10 years, and now you have killed everyone on this space station. I am 7 years away from Earth. All this you told me as you nourished me, stabilized me, revived me. How did you know how to treat me? To bring me back, to reverse whatever it was the device did. As you worked, I came to master your form of communication. Now I knew your story. Why? Was the first thing I said to you. Because it is what I am, you said. You immediately began to take my stones one by one to another place, the largest space I'd come through where the doors had closed behind me. The doors were still shut, everything in the room cleared. What are you? You asked as you moved my stones. I am me. You don't know. What else is there to know? Why did you come here? I have been to your planet. I have seen humans before. I was afraid then, but this time I was curious. You should not have come. I know that now. When I first saw you arrive, I thought you were some sort of spirit, you said. I said nothing to this. If I cure you, do you know what that is? Cure? Yes. If I cure you, will you kill me? No, You left me then, all my stones in that room. I wanted to ask you what you would do now. Would others come? Were you able to be alone as I was? You knew where you were from, what you were. And it seemed humans were always with other humans, even out there in space. At that time, I did not care to apologize. I was still angry. What the other humans had done to me was wrong and cruel and unearned. You'd left something beside my stones, a device. After you left it, it buzzed and sparked, and one of those sparks jumped and popped onto the nearest of my stones. And within moments, I ignited with electricity. Then I was up. The doors opened, revealing broken doors. These were the ones I had ripped open. I flew out. I only looked back when the space station was but a speck in the distance. I went on to visit Jupiter for a fourth time. But when I left it, I was in pain again. Listen, Shakuma, you brought me back. But you did not cure me. I did not want to fall apart in space, so I sniffed out the nearest solid place. It was as if it were meant to be, because that place turned out to be the comet you told me about. The comet I'd been looking for when I was distracted by your space station. The comet that was also my place of origin. I had not seen it in so long. I landed on its surface and immediately let myself disintegrate into a pile of stones again. This comet was my place of origin. Would it be my place of end? My chariot into death. Would I die? Could I die? So here I am, a pile of stones again, on the comet hurling toward the sun. Will you get this message through your mysterious plant friend? I don't know. I can send radio waves and receive them. I could hear your plant speaking while you healed me. I asked it what it was, and it told me more than I will ever know about myself, I suspect. It had an entire history, and it was so proud. You were a part of its history. So I suspect you will get this message if you are alive. I hope you are alive. Listen, I am so sorry. I am sorry for killing all those humans. I am sorry for leaving you there all alone, fully alone, for years. Who knows the damage I did to your home? You were doing your life's work with those alien plants. I can tell you what they were, for I have seen them on a distant planet, and what you grew was never so healthy and lush on their home moon. You are a good farmer. Your family should be proud. Send. She was nothing but stones on a comet. She could look around, but she could not collect herself and fly away. For over a millennia, she traveled the galaxy. There was so much more to see, but she would never do that. She was sure of it. The sun was close now, and parts of the comet were beginning to melt and sizzle, its tail growing longer than ever. She still did not know where she came from, or if there were others like her, but she would have to be fine with that. A year later, she flew with the comet into the sun, and that was that. Except it wasn't. It took her 3 years to emerge from the other side of the sun, and when she did, she was not on the comet. Her comet was gone, burned up before it even reached the sun's corona. And there were two things she knew for certain. First, the sun had taught her, and the second, listen, had taught her. What the sun taught her was that she could not die. Why she ever thought she could was laughable now. She was not like the creatures on Earth, never had been. The second thing that she now knew after traveling through the sun, she acted on immediately. She shot off sniffing and sniffing. For her, it was not long, only a few hundred years. She found the comet with multiple nuclei far beyond the solar system, far from the strange planet called Earth. The comet was heading in a direction she was curious about, and she decided to stay on it for a while. As she knew she would, on its several surfaces, she found more stones. In time, those stones gathered and became. There was no name for what she was, but there were more like her on this large comet. 5 of them. She taught them everything she knew, and soon they left the comet a powerful and bonded family of travelers. And they saw much, and continue to do so to this day. Because the universe is full of infinite wonders. What are your thoughts on the story? Please send me an email letting me know what you're doing while you're listening to the podcast, what stories you like, all that good stuff. You can do so at kate@clarksworldmagazine.com. We have a new slate of stories for you this month. I do hope you can come back and join us, should you so choose. And until then, my dear listener, I bid you a very fond and hopefully very temporary farewell.